Tokyo is a world in itself. More than 30 million people live and work in this gigantic metropolis. The Japanese capital is a densely woven patchwork quilt of buildings and traffic arteries and a round-the-clock hive of human activity. There are hardly any public squares and virtually no parks. Land prices are astronomical. Like many of Asia's new megacities, Tokyo is a masterpiece of multi-stacked levels for people and traffic. Architecture versus the landscape and tradition in the cause of maximum profit. That used to be the maxim, and as a rule, it still is. To find peace and quiet, and to have an uninterrupted view of your surroundings, you have to escape from the city and drive for more than an hour. In this respect, however, things are changing more and more. Of late, a form of architecture has been emerging which respects the landscape and strives for harmony with it. It seeks to reintegrate rural elements, as well as tradition, into an urban setting. This new architecture creates complete settlements in the attempt to give the city dweller of the 21st century something which was still predominant in Asia only 50 years ago. Yokosuka lies on the coast. It can be reached from Tokyo by bus or subway. Located behind the city is a bay. Here, the municipality has had an art museum built, which blends in easily with the landscape. Visitors can enjoy both the art and the view. The museum was designed by world-famous architect Riken Yamamoto.
The location is called Uraga Suido. It lies at the narrowest point of Tokyo Bay.
For the military situation. So there are many guns around the place. So it's a secret place for Japanese people for a long time.
But that is precisely why the original landscape has been completely preserved. When I came here for the first time, there was a small pond surrounded by woods. Viewed from the sea, the landscape looked like an architectural ensemble. It was extremely beautiful. So in creating my building here, I wanted to leave as much as possible unchanged.
There are countless parallels with many museums worldwide. Take, for example, the elegantly curved walls and winding staircases, and the use of natural light, but there are doubtless very few other museums which subordinate their exhibition rooms to the landscape to such a degree that they are almost hidden in it. Thus, viewed from above, the museum seems first and foremost like an observation platform.
You have the sea, and when you enter the museum from the ocean side and move upwards, you go straight into the park. When you reach the roof, you are on exactly the same level as the park. The building is set in a hollow in this slope. The entrance area was adapted to this hollow. You come in here and are then led upwards to the roof as if you were on a terrace. This terrace forms a unit with the landscape. Stretching out in front of it is the endless ocean.
Horizontal lines predominate, in stark contrast to the vertical lines of a megacity. In this way, the architect wanted to preserve an unobstructed horizon. The predominance of horizontal elements is interrupted solely by the small building for stairs and lifts which lead into the museum.
The roof merges just as harmoniously with the landscape as the ground floor where the entrance area is located. The museum is located precisely at the point where the sea merges with the mountain, and it is half underground. I wanted to build it in such a way that viewed from the ocean, it does not hide the forest. So anyone looking at it from a ship should be struck more by the forest than by the building. After climbing the stairs, you can enter the park. Viewed from this side, half the building is hidden in the ground and is thus invisible. And here, there are lots of trees growing. As I said, when seen from a ship, I only wanted the mountain to stand out, not the museum. I wanted that to almost disappear. So right from the start, I had the idea of designing a flat building, one half hidden in the ground. I simply found the landscape so beautiful and wanted to preserve it with my concept.
Like the walls, the roof of the museum consists of a double skin of glass and steel plates for controlling the incident light. By contrast, the rooms in the interior are like hidden boxes and form a marked contrast to the glass cube, which subordinates itself to the trees and the hill and, above all, aims to be a part of the landscape. From Japan and the bay near Tokyo, we move on to the Yangtze in China and a megacity in the west of the country. Chongqing too is home to some 30 million people. The city vies with Tokyo for the title of the world's biggest urban agglomeration. But in contrast to the Japanese capital, Chongqing is still steadily growing. So how will its inhabitants live? What does Chinese architecture look like, which strives to do more than just copy American cities? How can rural and urban elements be combined? This is something Ma Yansong, one of China's most influential young architects, focuses on.
In the project in Chongqing, it's a high rise. It's a single high rise. And we try to put a lot of gardens into the high rise. So high rise is not only about the shape, but also about individuals who live in there. And we try to make a high rise look like an organism, not something about sculptural.
The rule where megacities are concerned is for high-rise apartment blocks to be built close together. No one building relates to another. They don't form any kind of public square. They merely stack people. There's no neighborhood, no communication, no identity.
And then later we found more and more high-rise requests in different places in China. Then we found sometimes this has a very beautiful nature, sometimes this place has a mountain before. So we thought maybe we should learn, you know, the old people in the past, how they make a city or make architecture. They always treat architecture as a landscape or part of landscape. There are columns on the facade, and here you see the floor. So here can be gardens, you know, trees, whatever. And here, maybe we have a waterfall coming here. Mm-hmm. Here we have a water pond. So you can have a bridge go here. This is a beautiful scenery. Normally you can only find in the mountain. But if this happened in the city, then it's great, I think.
In the city of Baihai, on the South China Sea, Ma Yansong's firm is building a huge residential complex. Fake Hills, as it is known, consists of thousands of apartments designed like this and grouped as an ensemble so that when viewed from the sea, they look like a collection of hills. In reality, however, these hills are giant high-rise apartment blocks. they are just as much a compacted megacity as the conventional residential high-rises in Chongqing. The rural design of ranges of hills and vistas and valleys which are created within the residential complex are intended to please young Chinese whose grandparents knew nothing but villages and countryside. This city, which very few people outside China know about, has been exploding for 10 years now. In the near future, this young metropolis is forecast to become one of the fastest growing cities in the world. Its architects have to build on a compact scale. But it is not just comfort and a view that residents want. They also have a need for something akin to an identity, an urban feeling different from that found in big cities in Europe and America. There is history to Baihai. This was one of the coastal starting points of the Silk Route. Ma Yansong's concept is that of a scenic architectural landscape which reflects the difference between Chinese and Western culture. That countryside has a direct spiritual importance. If this has been lost or is no longer attainable, it is imitated in the form of architecture. Avant-garde architects strive to transform the city back into countryside, to give it a soul, an identity. China's rapidly growing megacities cannot develop like European cities, for example, which had plenty of time to do so. To retain a balance, Asia's megacities want to become urban landscapes.
Chinese urbanization is a real challenge for architects of this generation. So if we say we don't want to just repeat the North American way to make new cities, then what's the new way? That's the reason we have to do research and experimental designs.
We find another example of rural architecture in the province of Anhui in central China, not far from one of China's sacred mountains. This is a spiritual landscape. Here we find limestone cliffs, Lake Taiping, and the silhouettes of the mountains. On the southern shores of the lake, Ma Yansong's firm is building the Huangshan Mountain Village, a kind of vertical settlement that nestles into the landscape, trying its level best to become countryside itself. This too is high-density architecture, residential complexes of up to 20 stories, high-rise buildings, in other words. But that's not the impact they have. The buildings are aligned to one another in different ways. They seek to be part of the hill or a jagged cliff. They are contoured. Not some kind of mass product, they create an organic effect, like nature, because they avoid right angles. These are luxury apartments for a generation that grew up in the city and remembers the tales told by its grandparents. Stories of villages, mountains, lakes and rivers. Settlements like this satisfy their yearning for a life outside the city or nurture their distant memories of it. The buildings nestle so elegantly into the landscape that, in an ideal case, they appear to be a part of it. As we saw earlier in Baihai, this is the concept of a modern scenic architecture intended not to extend the city, but to dismantle it or erase memories of it. Here, landscape and tranquility are a luxury, just like natural contours in a megacity. In Beijing, there is a large illuminated hill with soft contours. It could have been brought to the city from the Yellow Mountain. Galaxy Soho is a high-rise complex consisting of offices and a shopping mall. Designed by star architect Zaha Hadid, it is the biggest urban complex in Beijing. Ma Yansong worked with Zaha Hadid. So it's no accident that his fake hills and this high-rise hill look like distant relatives. The contouring of the external forms is elegant, amorphous, flowing, and dynamic like organic matter. This building doesn't seem like a high-rise structure, even though it is one. People can spend hours in Galaxy Soho, screened off from the noise of the city in an urban landscape that is rich in variety. These are the new central squares in Asia's megacities because they have what the surroundings lack, a balance of scale. The importance of urban centres like Galaxy Soho to a city like Beijing cannot be rated highly enough. Traffic in the Chinese capital is endless. It has grown around the old imperial city in concentric circles, which were simply increased as though they had simply been stuck on. There's no link between the outer, new city and inner Beijing. Just traffic. The inner city with Tiananmen Square and the Imperial Palace is the only real centre that Beijing has. A tiny grain of sand in a desert of asphalt and concrete.
For China, I think the main conflict is the modern image and the traditional philosophy. How people think the ideal way to live in the future. What's a future city? That's a simple question. Nobody can answer. If you ask a government official, they will think a city like Chicago is great. But people, maybe they forget we had beautiful cities before, like Beijing, like Suzhou, Hangzhou.
The hutongs of Beijing are perhaps the exception in this megacity. From the outside, they might seem like slums or horizontal favelas, but in reality, they embody the only urban ensemble that Chinese culture ever produced before urbanization began. Even in Chinese, the English term courtyard houses is used to describe them.
I think the Chinese architecture, the courtyard layout, the city layout, has a lot to do with the social structure. Like each courtyard is one family, and they have their own space. When they go out, they share with other people. That's the public space.
For a long time, Beijing's hutongs personified the city. They were identical with its horizontal spread. The courtyard houses are virtually all single-storied. It's very rare for them to have two floors. The more prosperous the family that resided here, the bigger the courtyard. A garden stands for opulence. Trees are a touch of countryside in the middle of town. This is the first association which Chinese urban culture offers, a village idyll in an urban environment. Ma Yansong's bubble was originally an art project for the Biennale in Vienna. Later, both elements were integrated into an extensive courtyard house that was renovated at great expense. The bubble contains a modern toilet and a spiral staircase leading up to the roof. Ma Yansong's design was intended as a provocation, a cry that modern forms should help to lead that which is worth preserving into the future. Thus, this rural idyll in the city, which in addition to living space also contains a wine shop, was also given a luxury court toilet and a roof terrace. Pai Zhu, another architect of international renown, has also turned his attention to the Chinese courtyard house.
Chinese architects had little time for reflection. Without having pause for thought, they immediately became part of the urbanization trend. As a result of this rapid development, we lost a lot of interesting things which we could actually improve. If contemporary Chinese architecture showed greater regard for nature, our cities really would have their own individual features. We should think more about geography, topography, and climate, and above all, more about what is unique in Chinese culture, which is totally different from European culture, with its impressionistic and semi-abstract vein in art. That would make our cities unique.
The Chinese courtyard house is an ensemble of buildings grouped around an inner courtyard that can vary in size and sometimes encloses a small garden. They are designed like a three generations house. The grandparents supervise the children. The residents all have different rooms grouped around the courtyard.
It's not only the way of thinking that distinguishes Chinese from Western culture. The starting point is also different. What is more, our view of the natural Chinese landscape is very different from the Western view.
The fact that an architect like Pai Zhu should take an interest in renovating a courtyard house has to do with its symbolic importance. It stands physically close to the Forbidden City in surroundings that always belonged to Beijing University. So it is like a physical symbol of the tradition of a Chinese form of urban architecture whose message modern Chinese architects are bent on preserving. Standing in the old part of Shanghai is a factory building where clocks and watches were once produced. Now it is the headquarters of a company manufacturing high-quality lamps. The old building was completely gutted and is dominated internally by a hall that extends right up to the top floor. Horizontal steel bands in the facade and a similar structure in the interior, plus matte stone, glass, and above all, water with a slightly greenish shimmer to it, lend the whole interior the atmosphere of a 21st century botanical garden. The complex was designed by Kengo Kuma, whose architectural creations are found all over the world.
I would actually like to musicalize architecture, because although music doesn't have a fixed form, it designs or shapes time. I would like to see shape disappearing in architecture too, so that only time remains.
Water trickles down the four-story hall all day long, ensuring not only a refreshing climate, light is pleasantly refracted. The bright glare from the building is dulled and the loud noise from the street muffled. A kind of vertical garden has been created, a synthesis of sound, light, and the fluorescent shades of green.
The facade of the Z58 interfaces with the street. But the facade has a dual role. It also provides a view of the water behind it. So the main role is played by water. And this water behind the facade is actually a kind of waterfall. And through it, water circulates throughout the entire building. I didn't want to show this directly, however, but to have it indicated through the slats of the facade. This play with hints is an important element of my architecture.
Thank you. It is a building devoid of plants, yet it exudes something of what we expect from the countryside: peace and quiet and many degrees of shade instead of bright light. And when we add the predominant element of a Japanese garden, water, this office building has something of an island in a large city. A small park that radiates meditative calm, even though it is a purely functional building. The Z58 is a masterpiece of architecture combined with landscape in a big city.